I talked about it in the WrestleMania 10 review, that what a difference a year can make. Everything that WrestleMania 9 wasn't, everything WrestleMania 10 was. And then a year later, everything that WrestleMania 10 was, WrestleMania 11 wasn't. Make no mistake about it, I don't think you will ever see anybody that you will take with any type of credibility or seriousness ever refer to this as a great WrestleMania, and I truly mean that. This, to me, easily is one of the worst WrestleManias of all time. While not quite on the level of bad of a WrestleMania 9, it definitely battles it out with shows like 13 and 27 as being one of the worst. There were a lot of things wrong with this show, and just a lot of things that went very poorly for the WWF. Here you have WrestleMania at the Hartford Civic Center in Hartford, Connecticut. And I mean no offense to anybody, any of the good people there in the great state of Connecticut, but you know, you're so close to the New York area. You had just had WrestleMania 10 in Madison Square Garden, the mecca of sports entertainment, if you will. And then you go to the Hartford Civic Center. But that was the least of the problems with this show. I think in 1995, you may have had the single worst year in the history of the WWF in terms of maybe the business of the WWF, but more importantly, just the overall interest in the product. I mean, it was bad. And the WWF was incredibly out of touch with mainstream and just with the wrestling fan base as a whole at this time. And you could even see that play out throughout this show. Now, this was a WWF that was clearly in a recovery mode, that was trying to stem the tide of some negative press that had come its way from the early 90s, whether that be the Pat Patterson, Terry Garvin, Mel Phillips sex scandal story, the steroid scandal. There were a lot of things going badly for the WWF. People like Hulk Hogan are gone. The Macho Man Randy Savage is gone. So some of the bigger stars that you had built your brand around in the 80s and the early 90s were no longer in the fold, and they were over in WCW. So the WWF was hurting in a bad way. It was a bad time for the company, and this show kind of shows this. Now, I will say I've often heard this referred to as a one-match card, and I don't buy that. This wasn't just a one-match card. There was more than one match that I feel was actually WrestleMania-worthy on this card. In terms of in-ring action, I think WrestleMania 9 was much worse than WrestleMania 11 was. And I think it was much better, WrestleMania 11 was, than, let's say, WrestleMania 13. But there are a whole lot of other issues that really just help contribute to this being a bad, bad event. Your opening tag match was the Allied Powers versus the Blue Brothers. It was just kind of what it was. That's the truth of the matter. That's the best way I can put it. It just kind of was what it was. Nothing special, nothing memorable. The next match on the card, though, even though it involves one of the people in the wrestling business that I hate the most as a fan ever, in Jeff Jarrett, I cannot deny that Razor Ramon versus Jeff Jarrett for the Intercontinental Championship was a solid Intercontinental title match, even if I didn't like the finish, even though I hated the Jeff Jarrett character at this time, like I always have, and in particular hated this particular incarnation of Jeff Jarrett's gimmick. I cannot deny that he and Razor Ramon went out there and had a very good match. They told a good story, and you know, it was one of those things that if you had this type of match on a WrestleMania today in terms of an Intercontinental Championship match, people would probably be praising it and talking about that's why it was one of the best matches of the night. But since it was part of such a bad show, I think over the years, a lot of people forget about it, and it kind of gets kicked to the curb, and it falls by the wayside, which I think is a bit of a tragedy and a bit of a shame. It always is funny to me going back and watching Jeff Jarrett during this time and seeing the Road Dog being the roadie. Yeah. In 1995, Road Dog was the roadie. By 1999, he's a part of the hottest group in professional wrestling at the time in Degeneration X, and he's the Road Dog. It's amazing. Again, this just talks about how out of touch the WWF was at this time with what needed to happen in the business. After that, you've got The Undertaker beating King Kong Bundy. And of all people, they've got Roscoe, Illinois' own Larry Young, the former American League umpire, as a special guest referee. Now, I understand what Vince was going for here. Major League Baseball was on a strike. You had the 1994 World Series was wiped out due to the labor stoppage. And believe me, even to this day, almost 20 years later, I still hold a lot of animosity towards Major League Baseball for the fact that they wiped out a World Series. I'll never forgive them for that. 94 shaped up until August to be perhaps one of the greatest baseball seasons we had ever seen. You had people chasing the Triple Crown. You had, like, Matt Williams. You had Ken Griffey Jr. chasing Roger Maris's home run record. You had so many things going on. Tony Gwynn going after 400. Maddox had an incredible season as a pitcher. There were just so many things. The Expos looked like they could be World Series champs. The White Sox looked like they maybe were the second best team in baseball. There were so many things going for that season. One of the great baseball seasons that never was, frankly. So I understand the philosophy of bringing a Larry Young in here. I get what he was going for, but it was just stupid. And Undertaker versus King Kong Bundy, sadly, is definitely not one of Taker's better WrestleMania matches. I get the whole concept of with his feud that he had with the DiBiase family and what was going on here, that King Kong Bundy's a part of DiBiase's family. He's part of that whole kind of Money Incorporated deal. So as a result, he has a match with King Kong Bundy here, whatever, fine, but not one of those ones you need to remember, that's for damn sure. You had the tag title match, which was kind of fun to me because one of my more underrated tag teams of all time is Owen Hart and Yokozuna. And I always loved the fact that they eventually gave Yokozuna two managers. He had two managers. That's the awesomeness of Yokozuna. Now, it's kind of striking to me a year after he kind of, in a way, stole the show for me by working two matches that nobody ever gives him credit for doing. Working two world title main event caliber matches like he did at WrestleMania 10. Here he comes back with Owen Hart, with his manager, Mr. Fuji, and his American spokesperson, James E. Cornette. He and Owen Hart win the tag team titles, and this was solid. This was fun to go back and watch. It really was, actually. And again, I think it gets caught up in the perceived suck that was WrestleMania 11, because WrestleMania 11 was that bad. And one of the reasons it was so bad was because of the numerous technical difficulties throughout the night. You know, this is supposed to be your showcase event. This is supposed to be your biggest show of the year. And you had technical glitches and problems all throughout the night. This made WrestleMania 2 look like a smooth-running, well-oiled machine. That's not a good thing. This was horrible. You had things like Nicholas Totoro there as a celebrity, and nobody cared. I get that he was a part of NYPD Blue at the time, and it was a very hot show on television, but nobody cared, and it was just dumb. You know, you even had people like Pamela Anderson and Jenny McCarthy, you know, they were involved, and again, this was just kind of dumb. One thing that was awesome was Mr. Bob Backlund playing chess with Jonathan Taylor Thomas backstage. That was cool, but what wasn't cool, unfortunately, and this was a great surprise to me, was the I Quit match between Bret Hart and Mr. Bob Backlund. Now, these guys went out at Survivor Series 94, and I thought had a very, very good match. It told an incredible story, especially with the Owen Hart component and the Hart family component thrown in there. But now you get here to WrestleMania 11, and it just didn't work. This was, the best way I could put it, not good. You even threw Roddy Piper into the mix for whatever reason as a special guest referee, and this match just was awkward. It didn't work. Everything that their match at Survivor Series 94 was, this match here was not. And that's just the way it is. Now, the last two matches on this card, I feel, really saved this show from being the worst WrestleMania of all time, but it's still not that far away. Everybody talks about what the match of the night is, and that was the WWF Championship match between Diesel, who had Pamela Anderson in his corner, and his former boss, Shawn Michaels, who had Sid and Jenny McCarthy in his corner. Now, this is easily, I think, one of Diesel's best matches ever. WrestleMania doesn't matter. This is easily one of Diesel's best matches ever. And to me, it just kind of goes in the catalog of another great match for a Shawn Michaels. Now, you followed up his tremendous performance at WrestleMania 10 in that ladder match, in the IC title match against Razor Ramon. Now, he comes back here the next year, and you could clearly see WWF at the time, and Vince McMahon's love of the muscle and being the big marks and the muscle marks, where Shawn Michaels, I think, is surpassing Diesel in terms of an overall performer and entertainer, and Diesel is not exactly a big-time drawing champion at this particular moment in time, at least, but they weren't willing to go with Shawn Michaels here. And a lot of people have complaints about the fact that this match didn't main event. And I get that, and I understand that, and it was for the title, and it was with Diesel, and it was with Shawn Michaels, and maybe there was enough story there, and maybe the match was good enough that we could look back on it and say that it should have main evented. It didn't, but I don't think that necessarily in this case diminishes this particular match. This was a really good match, and sometimes I think it's underrated just how good it was. Definitely a match of the night, and definitely a match of the year candidate for the WWF in 1995. which isn't necessarily saying a whole lot, let's be honest. But the main event, the match that this show was built around, was Lawrence Taylor taking on Bam Bam Bigelow. Now, this had all been set up at the Royal Rumble after Bam Bam Bigelow had been eliminated. LT was sitting ringside, and he and Bam Bam got into it, and you were off to the races. Now, at the time, this would seem to have made a lot of sense. You were in Connecticut, so you were in that northeastern area, and Lawrence Taylor is arguably the greatest, I don't even know how much argument there is, he's the most dominant and greatest defensive player still to this day in the history of the National Football League. Bringing him in when he had retired a year and a half before from the National Football League, he was still a very relevant name. And as a result, when you look at Lawrence Taylor, he brought a lot of mainstream press and publicity in a good way to the WWF at a time where they clearly needed it. And you also look at the fact, you look at a Lawrence Taylor, this was a guy at that time still probably in his, what, mid-30s, maybe like 34, 35 years old. So he was a former world-class athlete and still was in incredible shape. So from an athletic standpoint, you had no doubts that a Lawrence Taylor could actually go out there maybe and not make himself look like an ass. The question is were he and Bam Bam Bigelow going to go out there and have a WrestleMania-worthy match and a WrestleMania main event-worthy match. Now, I think to me, this is the signature achievement of Bam Bam Bigelow's career. And again, talks about, to me, the greatness of Bam Bam Bigelow as a worker. You know, you're talking about a guy that was almost 400 pounds that could do moonsaults and all different types of shit. Bam Bam Bigelow was really damn good. And he and Lawrence Taylor managed to go out there and put on a respectable type of match, where you had to kind of mask and hide Mr. T a little bit with WrestleMania 1 and 2. You didn't have any of those same worries or concerns with Lawrence Taylor here at WrestleMania 11. Now, sure, he wasn't a Ricky Steamboat or a Ric Flair or a Shawn Michaels or a Bret Hart, but Lawrence Taylor didn't need to be. There was still an appeal here. There was still an attraction here to a Lawrence Taylor, a guy from the NFL world with his NFL friends around him like Ken Norton and Chris Spielman and Reggie White and so on and so forth, coming into the WWF's world and taking on a Bam Bam Bigelow. Now, one of the most controversial things about this, obviously, over the years is some people have a problem with the fact that Vince put over the NFL guy over the WWF guy. And that bothers a lot of people. And I get that, and I understand that. Now, ultimately, this was one of your featured attractions for the show. And Vince, at this time, still operated under a philosophy of as much as possible. You wanted to send the people home from WrestleMania happy. And if Lawrence Taylor was going to main event against Bam Bam Bigelow at WrestleMania 11, he was going to send the people home happy. And people might talk about the fact that this match was an abomination and it was a joke. I don't know what match they were watching. I have seen far, 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 far worse matches in WrestleMania history that featured better performers, that had better build, that were both parties were wrestlers. Any WrestleMania would be okay with having this be a part of the show. This is much better than having like a Big Show and Akebono sumo wrestling match at WrestleMania 21 or Big Show versus Floyd Money Mayweather at WrestleMania 24, just to bring up a couple of examples. This here was not that bad. And I think over the years, it's gotten a lot of undue criticism that it doesn't deserve. Yes, I get the whole standpoint of putting the NFL over the WWF, but hey, it was LT. And Bam Bam Bigelow wasn't going to be around much longer in the company. And you had built this event up. You had built this match up. You had to send the people home happy, especially when you talk about the WWF in 1995. And let's face it, frankly, Vince wasn't going to really go anywhere with Bam Bam Bigelow anyways. So why not have Lawrence Taylor go over here? This is not the worst WrestleMania of all time. I still feel that's WrestleMania 9. But this show was still bad. There are a couple of matches that I think get swept under the rug over the period of time, the IC title match and Taylor versus Bam Bam. And like I said, that was really Bam Bam's signature achievement to me in a good career. This is, to me, when you go back and watch, this is what shows you just how talented a Bam Bam Bigelow was and how good of a performer and an entertainer he really was. That he and Lawrence Taylor, and to Lawrence Taylor's credit, he took this seriously. Obviously, he prepared for it very well, got himself in great shape, and they went out there and had the best type of match you could expect between these two. This show was not as bad as 9, but all the technical problems, the pointless celebrity appearances, and you know the fact that this show only had seven matches and several of them you just didn't care about or they just didn't work definitely does make this, to me, one of the very worst WrestleManias of all time. No question about it. But WrestleMania 12, the company did some good things again.